Hey everyone, I'm ewhac.
I'm gammadev.
And we're back to our Let's Play video blogcast thing, and gammadev's brought a 3DO interactive sampler, volume 4, I think it said.
Yes. Which was something of a 3DO innovation, where we had, instead of nowadays we have downloadable demos, let me play for once.
Okay, sure.
Instead of downloadable demos, you had this thing where you would go into a store and you buy, you know, demos of all these games for $5.
Right,
and
because the bandwidth of a CD-ROM through the store was higher than your typical dial-up connection.
Yeah. Well, also, I mean, there's nothing to download into on the 3DO
online,
and there's no modem, except for that aborted AT&T model.
There's only one thing you need to know about us.
Your graphic design is terrible.
We got it. They don't.
So this must have been released like maybe one and a half years into the 3DO's...
or so, yeah. So
because this is the fourth one. This is the fourth one. And so, so let's see. Oh, hell. So yeah, so these are... that's by Captain Quazar, Cyclone Studios,
mm-hmm.
Bladeforce by Studio 3DO.
Studio 3DO, I think.
Who wrote?
Bill Budge. Yeah.
Yes, Mr. Pinball Construction Set, Apple Mouse, extraordinaire Mac Paint guy, Bill Budge.
Yeah. I don't know how he did it. He got the frame rate on that really, really impressive.
Ballz.
Yep.
Featuring voice work of Mr. Les Hedger.
Ah. First person pinball game.
No.
No,
Ballz is the 3D, and I have little air quotes going on right now
for you. Fighting game. Yeah.
For those of you watching at home, I'm making little air quotes when I say 3D fighting game.
Yeah.
Battlesport, also by Cyclone. We've done that in the past.
Covered that earlier.
The Ball Blazer update. Icebreaker, a lovely little isometric puzzle game.
I don't remember this.
Shockwave 2.
Yeah.
Space Hulk.
Ah, yes.
The early version of PO, the pre-release version of PO, complete with farting noises. We'll take a look at that. And Bladeforce. So what do you want to start with?
Ah, man.
I actually want to do PO because...
All right. Go ahead.
Who knows? Maybe we'll break this up into an extra long video or something.
By the way, two things that I've... discovered accidentally as a consequence of PO'd and Phoenix 3 is that apparently I wasn't the only one who discovered that everybody develops their games with the brightness on their TV sets set too high. So Phoenix 3 was dark, PO'd is dark, so I've cranked the brightness on the TV set, and I've now gotten into the habit of cranking the gamma on the videos before I publish them, so...
Hey, this would have been handy.
Yeah. Where could I have seen that? That wasn't...
Yeah, see, I love the fact that this is actually...
Take a picture.
They actually put this in the game.
Yeah.
And so the jetpack is C and R shift. Okay, that makes... Actually, I bet you I would have that in frickin' muscle memory if I...
Mm.
As soon as I start playing, because I've played enough of this game that eventually it would come back. Let's see. C is the combo... Okay, so A is jump and thrust. B is fire weapon. C is the combo key.
Yes.
Wahaha. Look at all those
C chord plus. Key. Yeah.
Next level.
C up, down.
Run mode. Play is run mode. Okay, interesting. Da da da.
What?
C up, tilt up, C down, da da, left, right, rotate left, rotate right.
Mm-hmm.
Wait, turn left. What is the difference between rotate left and turn left?
I think it's a camera move as opposed to a U move or something.
Huh. Or they mean like tilt left, right? They mean like...
I don't know.
Z versus...
I didn't explore it very much.
Well, I'll have to try that. Okay. Play. Yes, why they took that out of the shipping game, that would have been really handy to have that screen in the shipping game instead of relying on a printed piece of paper in the manual.
Right. Well, you know... Oh. Oh, they changed...
Okay, so you do have jetpack. And somebody online had mentioned double tapping the...
The jump button, you said?
The jump button would make you... So let's see. Well, that's interesting. Would make you do something. Would make you... Would do the jetpack, but then maybe that might be something they added for the PlayStation version. I would think that'd be annoying, because a lot of people would try and double jump.
Mm-hmm.
Jetpack action away.
Now go, gadget, jetpack.
Okay, how do you change weapons?
Oh, gosh. I think it's like, I can't remember which shift. Is it left shift? I can't remember.
Unless I don't have any weapons. I mean, I'm trying.
You may all have, you may have only the frying pan there.
Whoops.
Yes, this disturbing. Yeah, doing curiously disturbing character design seemed to be the thing back in the 90s.
Have you seen Doom?
Yeah.
Have you seen Doom 3? With like the baby heads upside down on spider leg?
No, kind of thing? I didn't play Doom 3. I downloaded the demo and I kind of went, no. Not.
I keep misjudging my distance here.
Yeah.
It seems like the texture stretching is a little...
texture crawl is a little distracting.
Worse for wear on this version.
Hello, we're skating. I can't remember how you switch weapons. Is it B? It's something... That's right. You have to, and then you have to pick one. And then, there you go.
Die, 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 die. Pew, pew, die, die. Yeah.
I don't know where the health is, or if there is indeed any on this.
Well, that was some health, but...
A little bit. I think you regenerate if you, like, hold still. Yeah.
Need to find some health. That's not a health pack.
No, I was fooled as well.
They may not to die.
Oh well.
This is the problem with starting in on
the
middle
levels,
level
yeah.
there.
Mm-hmm.
But where's the freaking farting noise aliens?
They weren't in that map.
Well, there might be more than one map on this. Because I seem to remember...
Yeah.
I seem to remember, like... I want to say it was... Rapa Nui was the map or something like that. Was the one that I remember playing in this one. Here, we'll try it real quick again. Now that I know how to... do some basic things, and I'll get rid of the damn frying pan. Yes. Thank you.
Yes, write all this down.
Mostly relatively short load times here.
Ow.
Let's see. What do I want here?
There's a meat cleaver. There's a distance zappy thing.
Die. Die like the dogs you are. See, pretty... Pretty good on that. Oh, wait, here. Let me try.
I think that thing in the end is a rocket
launcher. Yes, yeah. I was thinking about that. Oh,
boom.
Doesn't have the metal twang that they have in the final game, does it?
No. And not a very interesting looking font down there.
Yeah.
I think that's a built-in...
Now, if I remember correctly...
And around... Damn. Looks like it's got splash damage. Mm.
Teleportee. Teleporte. Hey, can I go?
Is that the escape button? It looks like the door is shut.
But I can...
Huh.
Hello.
What's around this corner?
Where we're going, we don't need roads.
More ammo. Very nice.
Like I said, the jetpack here is just very intuitive. I can still do it after all this. How far did you get after our last play session?
About four levels in. And then I just kind of like...
Oh, hello. Not hurting myself doing that, probably.
A little bit. Not as much as they are. Yeah.
Wow. Uh-huh. Whoops.
Ow. Ding.
It's like, speed this up here. Ah, hello.
It's totally good.
Wow. Okay,
then you got the flying guys. So is this the same? Yeah, it looks that way.
Where are you at? Oh, wait, maybe we want to switch.
Oh, this is a different hangar. That ship wasn't there before, so.
Pattern indicates two-dimensional thinking, Captain. Oh, so someone pointed out on our last video that, I'll say this now, I was wrong. Doom does do 2D BSP trees.
Ah, yes. I saw that comment as well. Yeah.
I guess that's mainly to accommodate the floor more than anything else. Because, I mean, they could do it with a raycast engine for the vertical wall, certainly, but I guess maybe just a massively... shoot, I need... Oh, fuck. Uh-oh, almost dead, aren't I?
Yeah. Oh, well. Well, we got to see a little more.
Yes. I didn't get to see the farting alien. I know there is, unless they did an earlier demo disc, and I'm not... what do you want to do here? Bladeforce? You want to see the...
Sure, let's see what...
on a large screen? This is probably going to be vomit-inducing.
I've never...
Remember the at the E3 they demoed this at where they had like the gyroscope thing that they would strap people in? It was like the... Literally, it was like a...
Really?
You would...
Welcome to Mega Grid. The year is 2110. Chaos, mayhem, and destruction.
Matrix Bank?
Yeah.
Don Matrix?
A city taken over by crime lords like Terrence Pitt with his...
Oh, yeah. All these people are people who worked at 3DO, these likenesses.
...world with an iron fist. Steel Medusa sisters, the product of a biometal...
I don't know who this is supposed to be.
...gone bad. Pyromegaly. This escapee from an insane asylum uses...
Ones I don't know for sure, I'm not going to guess who they are because they might be affected by that.
Ever popular with the ladies, Eddie Ecstasy is the undisputed...
Oh, I think... I don't know if I want to say who that is. Basically, go through the credits of this and look at like... Okay, I'll say it. That's Becky.
Really?
Yes, that is definitely Becky.
Uses doomsday hysteria to steal your money. Ugly two-head.
I believe those are like the two engine leads there. One is...
Basically, you know, looking for...
This sleazy lawyer only represents...
Looking for... We need somebody who can, like, stand around for a long time for the 3D digitization process.
Oh, did they scan these guys?
I think they were partially scanned.
With the help of Dr. Grubert, you will take to the sky, seek out your enemies, and destroy...
Oh, there's a whole bunch of stories about Bladeforce. One was that Becky used to tell me. Uh-huh. We might bleep her name out.
I don't know. That's
weird. She's not in the industry anymore, right?
No.
Which was, Trip really wanted that guy to have a cape.
Which guy?
Him.
Really?
So remember originally in the demo disc for, was it? Not Monster Manor, but what was like, was it Jurassic Park Interactive that had like the first demos that had like Killing Time? Also had Sky Viper, was what this was originally called.
Yeah.
But even before that, Trip really wanted this guy to have a cape and to be a superhero.
Uh-huh.
And everybody thought this was the worst idea ever.
Yeah.
And I'm sure to this day Trip believes this game would have been a huge hit if a Heath guy had a cape instead. But anyway, the way they got around this,
mm-hmm.
you'll love this. They said, oh, a cape would require too many polygons. Guy's a sprite.
Yeah.
it wouldn't have mattered. Was it suggested zone order, blah, blah, blah. Okay. Pits, collect power-ups, blah, blah, blah. Call up the map from the game for more details. Collect as many as you can. I know a lot of people, and I watched somebody very recently play this on another YouTube channel, mm-hmm. and couldn't figure out where to go. And I know this is a common complaint that people didn't realize you have to like destroy, the power lines
mm-hmm.
for this to work.
Oh, to
deactivate like there's a force
security
field.
Grid. Yeah.
And I guess it's not obvious like what these things are, the power conduits they're supposed to be.
Well, it looks like those glowing color bulb things there.
But apparently you don't target them is the problem.
Looks like you're not targeting much of anything.
Well, you know, but they're targeting... Yeah, basically it's like, if it's not dull gray, you could probably shoot it. But is it the...
Try the things spinning on the end.
Well, the things spinning on the end are power-ups that you collect.
Oh, all right.
The other thing that I remember about this game in particular was that they that there was a problem with is like the collision detection's kind of off.
Mm-hmm.
And if I remember correctly, it's because the original version of this and probably what the game code is based on.
Yeah,
is you actually see a full body of this guy. You see like
so
the perspective has kind of changed a bit.
Uh-huh. I think it's on the ground behind it.
What
they're supposed to be shooting at? Yeah, there it is.
I don't know if you're supposed to also shoot like the blue glowy things or not, but or you're supposed to shoot.
Yeah, I don't know if there's anything for like terrain damage.
It is nice that it, you know, it flashes like some kind mm-hmm. of, you know, when you hit something. That's pretty nice. But I watch people play this and I have the same problem myself. Is like it seems like you're like where you're colliding doesn't work. So if you try and fly under these, you'll get this mm-hmm. like I'm hitting something. It's like what? Why am I hitting above me?
Yes.
And it's because he's supposed to be almost like in the center of the screen.
Mm.
As like a full body kind of thing, and yeah, I mean, and so that was like a major problem I remember seeing when people would play this. Is like they've like it's hard to figure out like what you were hitting,
because mm-hmm. they were lining up the wrong thing, and I guess they couldn't.
It was fairly late in the game that they put that large sprite there. I think that's the thing. It used to be like if you even look at like the video for Sky Viper, mm-hmm. like or just the screenshots that was in. The early studio games.
Mm-hmm.
I think it was Jurassic Park has it. Where they're showing Killing Time, you know, concept art and all that stuff. It shows, like, the guy in the center of the screen.
Mm-hmm.
It was a big blow.
Hmm.
Like, see, there.
Yeah, yeah.
And so it's like...
And, of course, bumping into the thing with your rotating propeller blades...
Yeah, that would...
Does
that
not
would
cause catastrophic failure.
Well, clearly it's supposed to be a cape. Let's see, now I need some health is what I need.
It looks like it has a vertical compensation.
Like that,
and
I think
blew,
is what most
blew the wall open. Yeah, okay.
out of health.
All right. We don't have a death animation yet. It's not released yet. Yeah.
Do I get three guys or just one?
Oh.
I start you right where you
there
are.
You go. So it's like... Then you respawn 50 feet away with no penalty, scratching your head in bewilderment.
It's a Vita Chamber or whatever from Bioshock. Yeah. Just like... yeah, there's health right there. Yeah. Like right in these pits, mm-hmm. there's health. It's like, what can we make out of the fewest quads as possible? You know, looks interesting, essentially.
What the? Oh, I see. Oh.
Oh, that's interesting. I think that might be a bug.
No, I think that's supposed to be.
Well, no, but he's going. Difficult. A, he's going through things, and B, it just doesn't seem like the rest of the stuff. You know. Oh, I can just hold it down. I'm so used to like old games that don't let you hold down stuff. Mm-hmm.
You had to buy my the auto game. Fire peripheral.
Yeah, what the hell is that? Kids nowadays. Is that behind it?
No, it's he's nowadays. Blinking.
Okay. Nowadays, you have to tell people, like, you know, what's something. Beta release. I love that. It says beta release. It says right there.
Thanks.
See, like that, I thought I should have collided with that. Where, you know.
Yeah, I would have thought so too. But... Wow. Okay.
Yeah, that's pretty much what they do today, so... Yeah. Early 3DO innovation! But yeah, too many polygons. That's kind of hysterical.
No, the trip story, you know, deflecting trip story that I have concerns the 3DO mouse.
Oh, dear. Why was there one?
Well, that, the two, but...
it was good for Lemmings.
There was some... Mouse
actually does
games.
That is that I remember one of those games doesn't work with the like one of those mouse games that doesn't work with the mouse, and I thought maybe Lemmings was it, where I was like, oh, you gotta be kidding, all the games not to work with the mouse. Yeah. Oh wait, no, it does. That's right, it does. Oh, that's right, you gotta take these before they take off.
Yeah,
of course they don't take off until they're on screen, which is nice one, I guess.
Yeah, this to increase the sense of tension.
This is definitely now.
Damn.
Going back to
this down. Hey.
Yeah, going back to the PO for a second. It's like that's impressive when you think that controls that well on a D-pad.
Uh huh.
You know. I need some more stuff. I need like fuel.
I think those crates might.
Yeah, if I could blow them up. That rocket was not on screen, blockhead. How am I supposed to figure that out?
You must have, activated it.
Like one pixel that was
one
on
pixel.
Screen.
Yeah, it was in pixel, that's how it starts.
There is kind of a text... Tex Avery quality to this, where it's like little blinking eyes on a pile of dust.
Yeah. Is there another rocket back there? There it is.
Yes, we let too many rockets go, so. But what about the 3DO mouse you were saying?
Oh, so. 3D, so there's like, okay, we're going to do a mouse peripheral. And they said, all right, so... And all the engineers said, and it's going to have three buttons. And Trip, who basically brought up in the shadow of Steve Jobs, because he worked at Apple for a while. Yeah, that was quick. It's a shoot 'em up, what do you mean? Said, no, it's going to have one button. And basically all of engineering said, no, it's going to have three buttons. And he goes, no, it's going to have one button. Hmm. So he said, well, he says, okay, let's have a meeting and discuss it. So this meeting is held. It's just like all of engineering and a whole bunch of people. And Trip writes on the whiteboard, why not one button? And basically sets the terms of the debate. You know, like that's just why not one button? So it's like
because the 3DO
you have to convince
has...
me that it's not that it should not have one button. So they argue for I don't know how long. I wasn't there. I heard about this secondhand from somebody who was there. It's just like
because we're not adapting Atari 2600 games.
Yeah, and so
that have one button.
So they go on. It's just like no one button. The Mac mouse has one button. It's impossible to press the wrong button. It's just like well, actually, the Mac has a 4-button mouse. 3 of the buttons are on the keyboard.
Yeah. What the open apple, closed apple? Whatever,
yeah, exactly.
Clover, whatever.
Yeah. Alt, Control, Hyper, Super, Front, Top,
Shift mouse. Yeah.
And it's just engineering guys are just going, I can't believe this. And so finally, they're just sitting there and going, I don't know. And Tripp is just like being really smug and saying, ah, one button. And so finally the company lawyer, Jamie Cook says, well then I guess all we have to worry about is the lawsuit from Apple claiming that we infringed on their invention of a single button mouse. Poof. The mouse has 3 buttons.
Yeah. What? Nobody's playing for 2 buttons like the Amiga? PF.
So.
Do you know what the PF stands for?
Pure fucking.
Yep.
Yep.
But yes, this was an attempt to do a 3D fighting game.
Using those Euro balls.
Because, you know, yeah. Spheres look the same from every angle, so
yep.
Why not?
Yep. Yes.
So yeah, I mean, this was on like the Genesis and the NES. Mm-hmm. SNES.
So. This also had a wacky music track. Yes, remember all the special moves.
Am I not allowed to use him? Okay, I guess only the green ones are ones I'm allowed to use.
I guess so, yeah.
So I'm allowed to use Bruiser. Or Ronk. I wanted to use Zombie because I know that's Les's voice is in Zombie.
Right? Oh, I see.
Oh, you know, he's like supposed to be kind of doing like a, I don't know, like a Vincent Price kind of thing. See, look, I can move in 3-space.
Yeah, well, I mean, yeah, they're positioned in 3-space, but they're just really easy to render.
Yeah, see, the jump button on this is C. This is a bad controller.
I can't remember if you could reconfigure the controllers.
I would hope, but that would be awesome. Much.
There's some sound effect
library they're using. Yeah.
Yeah, because the other big fighting game was, I think, Naughty Dog's first release.
Yeah, Way of the Warrior.
Way of the Warrior.
Which people still hate to this day for various reasons. I think that's a...
Because it was too chunky?
No, it's... Rate? I have a... We maybe will do that game sometime because I have a theory about why that game pissed off so many people.
Yeah.
I mean... Obviously, Naughty Dog is talented because they're still around today. You know, yeah. They made the best game ever for the PlayStation 3 a few months ago with Last of Us. Yeah. They also did Uncharted and all that stuff. Mm-hmm. I mean, they're really good, and these guys are very talented. It's their first game. It put them on the map. Introduced them to Mr. Mark Cerny.
Yeah.
You know, but and they were posting very prominently on Usenet during the development of that game.
Yes.
And
just a couple guys in their bedroom, as I was given to understand. Well,
yes.
maybe a few more than that.
They basically got all their friends together and they digitized the graphics.
Dressed up in weird costumes.
And they were basically, I understand, it's like in their dorm room.
Yeah.
They would open the door, put the camera out in the hall because they didn't have enough space, and so they
didn't have a wide enough angle lens.
Yeah. So to digitize all these guys. I mean, yeah, you can tell it's like that's kind
of
like a
we're talking about Way of the Warrior.
Yes, not
something
this one.
Else. Yeah.
Yeah. Sorry. But we'll save that for when we cover Way of the Warrior. That one we will have problem with YouTube on because we'll have to turn off the music because it's White Zombie.
They licensed White Zombie.
Yeah. So I mean, basically it was like the game was pretty much finished, and then Universal, Mark Cerny saw, and then Universal Interactive picked it up, and they're just like, So what would you guys like as music? Like, White Zombie? Thinking like, no way. And yeah. Like, yeah. No problem. Because yeah, it's in our music catalog. So it's like, damn, we should have asked for like, you know, Stairway to Heaven or something. Oh, see. Finishing move of... I mean, this had a certain charm to it, but yeah, it's very lightweight as a 3D fighter.
Yes.
I mean, there aren't that many competitive American-made 3D fighters, you know. Basically, the only one I think of is Mortal Kombat. Mm-hmm. Everything else is sort of like, you know, they're not worried about the move sets as much, mm-hmm. you know, whereas, and like, the timing and stuff, so it's like...
Yeah, I was never really into the fighting games.
I mean, this is...
It didn't help that, like, the first fighting game I ever played was Karateka from the Apple II. Which had a frame rate of about 0.75.
No, it's not that bad. But at least you had a two-button joystick to play that with.
Yeah.
That's actually, the Apple II version, A, is the original version, and is also probably the best version of that. Certainly the ports of that have issues. Like,
the which version?
Ports of Karateka have issues like the Atari 7800 version is like the worst piece of crap. Where it's like they decided to redo the way the controls work. It's like you have a two button joystick, which is not afforded to you on other platforms.
Yeah.
Why on earth did you think to redo the control setup?
So we also wanted to work on the Atari 400.
Yeah. No, it's just horrible. Oh, look, a replay. See, I mean, director's cut. You see, that was 3DO got the director's cut. All right. It's just a case of like, if it's not broke, don't fix it. Because it would have had a smoother frame rate on the 7800 and stuff, but nope, the guy ported it, just said, we played Battle Sport.
Yeah. Space Hulk.
Oh, yes. Space Hulk. The game that looks like it should be a Doom game, but it's not. It's basically a 3D version of what originally is a board game. And actually, this is recently remade on a Kickstarter campaign.
Oh.
And it's actually, people apparently like it, and it's basically this version.
Huh.
Redone.
Huh.
With better graphics, obviously. But this is still pretty impressive when people saw this and like, oh my god, this still kicks Doom's ass. And then you realize you can't play it like Doom.
Yeah, it's not an FPS.
It's basically a strategy game. You're moving people down a horse. I mean, you do have a little bit. I think it's probably the first time example of like a quick time event in a game. It's like when the guys get up in your face, you have basically parry with them.
Yeah.
To try and... But that's basically like the most action you see. Normally it's like, move this guy down this... Because you have a squad that you control.
Mm-hmm.
And yeah, parry, close, open door, see, fire, weapon, hit. Again, this is something that doesn't appear... This screen does not appear...
In the actual
game. You actually have to look this up in the manual.
Oh,
like,
boy.
Why did people... What do they have against trees? What do you have against trees? And see, yeah, here's the idea: is you send guys like, you know, to different spots.
Right.
You send members of your team, and then you know it's like review objectives, names, and then also, hey, we've got the motion tracker from Alien. A very cool idea. This is awesome. It's very atmosphere, very atmospheric. What is Space Hulk demo? Let's see what this is. Probably I'm. Either it's a movie or let's say
self-playing demo. Here's how you could try. Yeah, this is
a game you. If you pick this up and you play like Doom, you're going to be incredibly frustrated, and you throw down the controller and take it back to the store.
Mm-hmm.
A power field generator must be positioned at this point. Two Terminators must survive. All surviving Terminators.
Here it's basically showing you like the overview of the objectives.
Mm-hmm.
And then it's like, I love that, the fact that you can take the radar, stick it down in the corner.
I can see them. There are hundreds of them.
But you notice you've got a whole legion of guys like behind you.
Since now you're just like walking in.
That's an example where you have to parry the guy. And that's when you fail to parry.
Uh-huh. That's just the guy in front. That's not your entire squad.
Hopefully.
Yeah.
Well, hopefully you're not supposed to get to that point. You're supposed to have the guy... Oh, That was lame. Hopefully you're supposed to get to the point where guys you position your squad members so like mm-hmm. you can't get, you know, in that position. They're mm-hmm. basically flank, you know, crossfire flanking mm-hmm. stuff like that. So
no, it's just, I tried playing it like Doom and didn't do very well.
Yeah, I kind of went, eh. It's your natural reaction to try and do that when you see that. So.
When you see it presented this way.
Yeah. But people who did play it as it was did like it, so.
Hmm.
Which is probably why. Oh, did I? Yeah. Oh, you got to debounce, guys. You got to debounce the keypad. Well, here. Can I hit the stop button and stop it? Was that part of. So do you know when they were making these, like, if there was any requirements, like, they have to, like, adhere to certain things, like the stop button will always take you back to the main menu, no matter where you are in the demo. And...
No, I don't think there was anything, at least not in the early days, there was nothing like that. It was pretty much, because, I mean, first of all, we had three buttons, plus the two extra in the middle,
plus
shoulder buttons.
How could you ever use them all?
Exactly. I mean, I don't know if this SNES had shoulder buttons.
Yes.
It did?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
Yeah.
They added that. So here, making sure I'm not. Okay, play mission. Yeah. Let's try this.
Mm-hmm.
Now, hopefully, they put you in an early mission as opposed to let's throw you in the middle of a firefight. Ha ha ha!
Yeah.
You are lost forever.
No hard feelings.
Here are your objectives: flame this room. Two terminators must exit by this point. Complete your mission within 2 minutes.
Nothing to worry about. Okay, now what?
Move to this point.
So yeah, so
you're strategically moving your guys.
Right. And then...
Oh, one, two. Oh, okay.
How do I scroll the map? Let's see here. Let me guess, do I have to hold down a key or something?
Ezekiel!
Oh, you're
sorry. Azrael.
Azazel. Oh, you're looking through. Here they come. Oh, it looks like your other two guys are just automatically blasting.
I can hear them.
Wait, is that where they res in? Those red arrows?
How do I?
Overwatch this direction.
Yep, that's where they res in.
Can I kill that? Can I kill the res spot?
I think you just like camp somebody on the on the side of it to
move to this point. Azrael. Move to this point.
Wow. Okay.
So yeah, I don't know how to
glory.
Okay, now I can control one of these guys. If I play, I can control one of these guys individually.
It's a library.
Oh yeah, it's kind of. It's supposed to be. It's almost like a space monastery.
All Terminator flamers have been killed.
Yeah. So then I kind of understand. So yeah, you can play it purely as an overhead strategy game, or you can do the first person thing.
Ah, okay.
But like I said, if you get into it, it is actually pretty mm-hmm. deep. And it's fun in its own right. Let's see. Let's do a little puzzle game.
Sure.
Icebreaker. Wahaha. Before there was. Well, let's see. I'm trying to think what game this is even like.
I don't remember this at all.
It's sort of like an action puzzle.
There was like a Bubble Bobble game for a long time.
It's
those poor.
All right. Basically, I think the idea is you want to clear all the triangles with your like little pyramid of death.
Hmm.
There was an Icebreaker 2, but it wasn't released, but somebody, one of those companies that, like, buys up old games, you see there's a zillion levels to this thing.
Hard, easy, oh god.
So, yeah. They released it after, I want to say it was like 2003 or 4 or something like that, they released Icebreaker 2, they found... basically a finished version of it that was on, you know, and they but it took them that long to figure out how to sign games
to crack the key to crack the signing key. Oh, my ride's here.
Right. So it's like certain ones you can go straight
yeah,
through.
Smash through.
Certain
yeah.
ones you can.
You have to shoot.
Like red ones, I guess, are dangerous. The only problem is you don't move on a grid. You have, you know, basically fine analog control.
Mm-hmm. Wahaha! Some of them spontaneously turn blue. That's nice. Oh.
You get one life, yeah. That's
really?
Oh. Yeah, why not? Yeah. So, yeah, you can see kind of what the idea there
oh,
is.
All right, okay.
I wish they'd make you move on a grid, though, because it's kind of like...
Mm-hmm. You have to... Oh, I haven't aimed right, therefore... Yeah.
Or, well, because, again, we have a D-pad here. It's like, yes. So it's too bad 3DO didn't live long enough for them to have their own version of like the DualShock, you know, or
yeah,
the dual analog sticks, or just one analog stick would be nice. Well, I mean, there is the flight stick.
Bumping your stumps for a couple of minutes. Actually, you mentioned you drew my attention to a post on the 3DO Zone, Interactive,
okay.
The forum, concerning people. Hey, I keep jamming things into the 9-pin port and they don't work. It's like Sega controllers don't work. And the old Atari 2600 controllers don't work. And I posted saying, no, don't do that. It's a custom thing. And then you suggested, well, maybe there's a possibility to create like an Arduino-based
right.
or custom logic goodie that would translate from modern USB peripherals to the old 3DO signaling. And technically, that should be possible. I wouldn't begin to know how to do it because USB HID is pretty hideous protocol.
I wouldn't be worried about the USB part because I've delved in that. I mean, people forever have, there's examples everywhere, like, you know, how to take a USB device and make it communicate to like an N64 controller and vice versa.
Oh, okay.
So there's a lot of examples about doing that. The issue for me would be the 3DO packets, which I have no documentation on.
Uh-huh.
I'm sure somebody does.
Hint, hint, hint. Yeah.
Special guest stars maybe for future yeah. broadcasts.
It could be, yeah. I don't know what that is offhand, but I do know that it was shared with other people because Logitech made compatible controllers.
Right. Or so. And think about that. Instead of using a costly 3DO mouse,
yeah.
using a regular USB mouse instead mm-hmm. would be kind of...
That'd be good.
That'd be a good idea.
Be interesting. An interesting project for...
For somebody out there.
Somebody, yeah.
But don't do it before I'm able to sell my complete inbox 3DO mouse on eBay or whatever. I gotta buy new toys, so you know, gotta sell the old ones first. See, I guess
Shockwave 2. I guess it's just the intro movie.
Really? Why?
I don't know.
Actually, the game itself would be less space than the intro movie. If you think about it.
Because it's just vertices?
Well, yeah. Okay, it is the intro movie. But I'm saying
yeah.
it would take less space.
It's not even an intro movie. It's a montage of the various...
This is the intro movie that you have on the Shockwave 2 disc. It's sort of like previously on Shockwave. Although it's missing a narration kind mm-hmm. of thing. But, okay, I mean, yeah, I mean, think about it. Video is going to be, you know, several megabytes,
mm-hmm.
right?
Yeah.
Versus the actual game engine we know can't be more than 3 megabytes.
Yeah.
So, plus graphics, and then, yeah. you know, if there's no streaming, then that's it, you know. I mean, this is actually coming. So do we have a playable level, though?
No, I'm guessing it's just the teaser video.
Still, it's impressive that you got that many games plus a teaser video onto just one little CD-ROM. How about that?
Mm-hmm.
That was even, because back then, well, think about it. You guess, you know.
Yep, there we go.
We got it. We got it. We got it. We got it. I'm sure they had endless meetings about which one of those
yeah.
they should underline. Or mm-hmm.
Well, it was their whole "we got it, they don't" that whole campaign.
I mean, also, I mean, these were also just great. This is basically an idea of like, let's take a disc that we would normally make for like dealers to put in their machines and,
mm-hmm.
and at GameStop or well, not GameStop back then. It was Electronic Boutique and Babbage's,
yeah.
and maybe Newegg. Although then it was probably Egghead Software.
I think it was Egghead back then.
And stick in there and run on a continuous loop.
And your occasional mom and pop video game store, which still existed at that point.
Yes, the good old days.
Yes, indeed.
Yeah. But, well, yeah, I would love to. Yeah, so people don't stick a Genesis controller or an Atari 2600 controller into the DE9 port on your 3DO. Don't do that.
Yeah. No,
totally. It's not going to be pretty.
No, not at all.
Although you can use the Genesis extension cords, because those are just straight wires.
Okay.
If you need extra length for some bizarre reason that your living room is longer than 10 feet
in width.
You can
use it for extra length, but not for extra controllers, because it has to be daisy chained. And if it's like one of those octopi, that's not going to work.
Yeah. Yeah, the extension cords are just pass straight signals, so that's okay. And that's okay. But we could put in another... What time are we up here? Sampler disc.
Let me look at this.
We could put in the Interplay specific... Because then once 3DO did this and they realized this is basically free money. Because, you know, it's like pressing a disc is nothing.
Yeah. Oh, it's all 3DO's money. Did these guys ever get a cut?
Probably not.
Okay.
And they're selling it for $5 a pop. So then individual companies like Crystal Dynamics made one. Interplay made one. What time is it?
We're coming up in an hour.
Oh. Well, let's briefly put in the Interplay's 3DO Buffett. I think this one is more movies than anything else, because if I remember correctly, there's one in here for Waterworld, the game.
Dear Lord.
Which is actually something that people have been seeking in various forms, because the game was never released. For both the 3DO, and there's also like a Virtual Boy version, which I might have seen a release in.
Oh, man.
Yeah, I know. But it's like, you know, think about it. You know, prototypes are rare.
Yeah.
So let's see what's on here.
Wow.
Let's mock at the movies of like, the hopeful future. What do we have on here?
Ah,
yes, the green marble that comes with every 3D package made back then. Interplay. I foolishly bought them when their stock it was like really low.
Uh-huh.
And I thought, it can't possibly get lower. I was so wrong. And then they went bankrupt, and then they came back as name only, and then, yeah, weird. And then they tried to sue the makers of Fallout over...
Oh, right.
Over
yeah.
that whole...
The name of the franchise.
The game they licensed to them, and then they said, no, we want to make an MMO. It's like, yeah, as if Interplay could make an MMO. or any real game at this point.
A smorgasbord for the mind. Okay.
Okay.
All right. Spinning. Stop the spin. Casper.
God, that's actually a good game. That's actually a very good RPG.
All right.
Which, I've got to figure out where the hell that went in my collection. Because I know I had that game.
Uh-huh.
Unless I gave it to my nieces. But I know I had that game. Because I think I sold the box for it. Kingdom the Far Reaches. Oh, it's playing itself. I didn't make a selection. And now it's not letting me select.
Right.
Well, we know this is video.
Obviously, this is going to be...
because this is all it is. Oh. That's all Kingdom the Far Reaches is video. Which is a reworking of the arcade game Thayer's Quest.
Oh, no. I tried playing that in the arcades. That was just like, it was unplayable.
Well, it had a keyboard.
Yeah, I know.
But basically, they took that animation, they redubbed it.
Yeah.
They added some new stuff, which you can tell immediately the quality difference. And then there is a sequel to this, which is the complete version, which is basically the second half, because if you play this game all the way through, you only get like the first few relics. So the guy Rick Dyer, he's the guy who made Dragon's Lair. He made Thayer's Quest for his Halcyon Laser Disc Entertainment System. It's a home system, cost $2,000 in 1982.
Ooh.
So basically it cost you a car.
Yeah.
In 1982. And that was like one of the games they'd made for it.
Mm-hmm.
He turned that into an arcade game, because actually the home version of it was actually a two-sided disc.
Mm-hmm.
You can't obviously flip a disc in the arcade.
No.
So,
you could. Hey, we're back. No, you could. Well, you could have like a double-sided laser player, but those were like even more expensive.
Oh, and actually at the time they didn't exist at that time. He made this. Yeah, I don't know. This thing has very little out of this world.
All right.
Let's just take a look at the... Oh.
It would have been funnier if it was the sound of a toilet flushing.
We have some... we have some Mac animation software, and damn it, we're going to use it.
Kerchunk, kerchunk, kerchunk. Since we borrowed some people from the mist.
Yes, Waterworld the game. Somebody somewhere, I'm sure, has a prototype version of this.
I never saw the film, so I saw fragments of it.
You're not missing much.
No, I didn't think so. Except for...
maybe get the Riff Tracks version of it or something. But, it was like the 1-2 punch that killed Kevin Costner's career. It's like that and then The Postman. Well, at the time this was made, this couldn't have been too far along, because there's really you're not seeing a coherent anything. You're just seeing snippets of the pre-rendered in-game movies.
Yes.
You know, it's like you're not seeing like gameplay. Anything that amounts to gameplay.
So where's the part where he urinates? Wait, fire burning underwater?
It's Tim Burton's Wind Waker. Yeah, I mean, this is weird because they're re-rendering special effects scenes from the movie in crappy CG.
Yeah, so what's down below, they're going to find that kid from AI. Man.
This was
just this much. Just this much work must have taken them months.
Just well, maybe. But yeah, you've never seen Waterworld. It's sort of like it was Dennis Hopper's warm up for being a bad guy in the Super Mario Brothers movie, essentially. So, oh wait, no, that's right. Waterworld came out after Super Mario Brothers movie. That's right. So yeah.
Dear me.
Yeah, that was not good.
Push the button, Frank.
I don't know if it's supposed. It's really weird what it won. When it wants you to interact and when it does it. Casper. Still waiting for like an actual playable thing in here. I'm guessing Wolfenstein is playable. And maybe a part of Alone in the Dark 2 is playable. But yeah, this is actually a really solid RPG.
Huh.
It's actually really good looking, too. Barring this crappy intro movie. I mean... The movie Casper had really good production design on it. I mean, the house, if you've ever seen the Casper movie.
I saw pieces of it.
I mean, the production design was really good on that thing.
Huh.
And, you know, you could tell they had a lot of money. I think Spielberg was an exec producer on that. I want to say that was...
To say they had too much money on it.
But yeah, the...
Act 1. Find tokens of friendship.
But it's because your main character is Casper, right? And so he's got various ghost powers that you have to use. To like, you know, like you can go through vents and stuff. And
yeah, I see. Looks like you're just watching a movie.
Well, yes, I'm. This is not because the in-game graphics aren't digitized like this. Obviously, they look really good. It just shows so you could make a really good Japanese RPG on the 3DO. I mean, graphically, in a lot of ways, this looks better than even, like, say, Lucian's Quest, which I do have a copy of, we'll have to look at.
Oh, man.
Which is, like, that and Guardian World are basically the only two... Well, there's a few others. What's the other one? There are a few Japanese RPGs, but that one is, like, the most typical, like, Final Fantasy-style RPG. Is Lucian's Quest. Where it's, like, sort of isometric. I mean, it's fully 3D rendered in the sense of the landscape and stuff, but then you have the sprite, but the attacks and everything are straight out of Final Fantasy. But yeah, so this thing is like you're exploring this huge ass mansion. You know. Yes, why you can't go through a gate? I guess maybe it's made of iron or something. Ghosts have issues with iron, I guess, is the issue. That's common in ghost lore, it's like.
Really?
Yeah.
Okay.
Which is always. Shows up as a joke in some things like. So basically, a fireplace poker.
Yeah.
Why do we have this in the house? If I'm living in this house, I'm a ghost. And so, ghosts can't pass through iron, apparently, or something. Yeah. That's some, you know, well, Is that any worse than garlic? I mean, come on. Alright, Alone in the Dark 2. Yes. The first one was good. It could have used a little more optimization. The second one is...
I played the original on the PC.
Yeah.
Alone in the Dark.
I played it on the 3DO. It's a decent thing.
Uh-huh.
I mean, predates Resident Evil.
Yeah. Oh, Chrysalis. So I don't know if they're the publisher or the developer.
The second game, if I remember correctly, like the original creator of that didn't have much to do with.
Play anyway.
Why? We're not going to save. What the hell? Oh, I wonder if you could do that. I wonder if you can play at this
point. And then buy the commercial version and then pick up where you left off.
Yeah.
That'd be good.
That would be a 3DO innovation. Now let's see the 3D spinning version of the logo. Oh, nope. They didn't bother.
Yeah.
The original one, they bothered. Actually, I don't remember if they improved the frame rate from the original version on the 3DO or not. I mean, original Alone in the Dark is a pretty good survival horror game. Like I said, it predates Resident Evil.
Mm-hmm.
I'm thinking of the third one. That takes place in the Wild West. This is... The second one is the one that takes... I don't think that one ever made it to the 3DO. The second one is the one that... It's basically kind of like a retread of the original.
Mm-hmm.
Am I doing anything?
Yeah, this is about right. I don't know. Are you doing anything?
Nope, I'm not doing anything. But then again. I mean, they certainly got more ambitious in the second one.
Yes.
In terms of, like, the number of characters and stuff they tried to put on.
Mm-hmm.
You can also hear this thing, like, seeking like a like crazy on this thing.
Yeah.
As it's trying to load all this stuff up.
Mm-hmm.
How were the layout tools on the 3DO?
In terms of
like making sure that things were all together and everything?
You could... So there, Dave Platt did create a tool that... what you would do is you would run the game in simulation first.
Right.
Which would basically... be files on the Mac. So the file requests would go back out over the fiber optic cable into the debug card, and then it would be satisfied by the Mac.
Yeah.
And he had a little thing that basically watched the activity of which files were being accessed when.
Hmm.
And then based on the data that he collected, would attempt to lay out your game so that things were pretty much in order. So there was some work done
on that. Some of those guys must have then went to work at Microsoft, because Microsoft has a very similar thing to that.
Really?
And Sony never did, as far as I could tell.
Huh.
And that was always problematic for getting, you know, disk access, you know, optimized. Uh-huh. And it's very handy to have stuff laid out, you know, get usage data and have it laid out properly.
Yes.
I'm not playing it. This is basically the intro movie, mm-hmm. but it's done as sort of live rendered. But
mm-hmm.
but yeah, and so what people would do, even up to the play, this is kind of funny, they did this on the PS2, they would just basically take the Xbox layout of all the files.
Yeah.
And put it onto the PS2.
Uh-huh.
Which is fine because they're both DVD-based, but then the 360 comes along, 360 is DVD-based, and the PS3 is Blu-ray-based.
Yeah.
They didn't really have an equivalent tool yet, either on the PlayStation 3.
Huh.
And so they would still just take the Xbox version of the layout, which is kind of odd because it was optimizing for things like, you know, the dual layers on the disc and everything, and like inner and outer rings of that.
Uh-huh.
And,
yeah.
I mean, as we're switching, but they still figured, it still worked better than nothing at all, you know. For
nothing.
The French. There's
wake up. Yes.
That's not creepy at all.
No. you simple poor man.
Yeah, I don't remember the second one getting as good reviews as the first one of this. I mean, it must have sold well enough that there was a third one, but the great thing about the first one was there was always a sort of action solution to a problem, and there was always, like, you know, a puzzle solution to a problem.
Yeah.
So it's like you could actually get through the entire Alone in the Dark without firing a single weapon or getting into a single piece of combat.
Mm-hmm.
There was always an alternative solution to every problem in the game that you didn't have to fight your way out of, which was...
Can you do quite, anything at this point, or quite, is he just...
That was quite interesting that you would... yes, spherical things again, because...
And you're dead. I can't tell if there was any point of this that was interactive, but like there was some way to you were supposed to avoid the evil clown. Oh, maybe not.
No, I remember this being the intro to. This is basically how the intro plays out in Alone in the Dark,
mm-hmm.
too.
Well, the intro in Alone in the Dark is you walk up to the top of the house.
Right.
Yeah.
But yes, this is sort of like, you know, somebody went into the house, blah, 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 da, mm-hmm. da.
Uh-huh.
Oh, it is the same guy.
Blazing through those credits there.
Very, very French.
Yeah. Infogram, yeah.
And you don't get to play any of that, do you? Oh, yes, you do. Okay, because why do you need a save slot for seeing the intro? Interesting to see how much they put on here.
That was another reason with disc layout is because when I was doing Monster Manor, I realized that I had, like, you know, 30 different textures for walls alone, at least. And I realized that if I had to, like, at the beginning of the level, like, open and close, you know, open file, read, close, open next file, read contents, close, that I was going to be in there for, like, you know, 50 seconds, you know, minute and a half, just loading up the individual textures, which is why I created the loaf format,
right.
So that they would all be in one, so open one file, slurp it all in, fix up the pointers, you're done.
You mean like the pack files for Doom and stuff?
Something, actually, a pack file is a zip file.
Okay, so this is me actually moving around.
Yeah.
Whee! Tank controls. Clearly something that Resident Evil took and didn't get rid of for many, many years. I think the first time you got screen relative controls bite or push? Push. So basically you have to get into like two different modes, I guess. Mm-hmm.
What?
Okay. So A is like the action. Oh, I should have maybe taken out the fucking revolver, shouldn't I?
Alone to
use.
You pointed my direction. Chunk, chunk, chunk. And it's seeking like mad.
I keep hitting the B button. They really could have used...
Yeah, more help. Oh! Ooh! Ooh!
That's a really good weapon he's got there.
Yeah. I'm sorry, you can't leave. You can check out any time, but you can never leave.
I could get run over by a car? Yep. If you try and leave, you get gunned down by the car. Okay.
Alrighty.
But yes, the tank... Yeah, this game is fairly unforgiving.
Sure looks
like
that way.
Second one. But there you go. Alone in the Dark. And then, yes, you get to see them take your body.
You know, throw it into the whatever. Ah!
It's sort of like Monkey Island, except you can die in this game.
Honestly. Yeah. I think you can die in Monkey Island, but you have to work at it.
No, you absolutely cannot.
Really?
You cannot.
There's this one part where they throw you underwater, and he says, I can hold my breath for 15 minutes. So I'm just wondering, well, what if you just stick around
yes.
for 20
Yes, if you
minutes?
Wait for 15 minutes, that's probably an achievement on the Xbox version before that. But you can, because I had to try that.
Yeah.
And then it's like, no, that's not what happened. It's sort of like, basically, there's a few points in the game where it's like you die.
Uh-huh.
Where you think like you die, but then it's like he's telling it in flashback. Mm-hmm. And he's go, no, that can't be what happened. And it basically restarts the section again.
They were good.
And, they made fun of the fact that at the time, like, games like... God, we're talking about another game.
Yeah.
Sierra Online games like Leisure Suit Larry, Police Quest, Space Quest, King's Quest, a lot of quest games.
Yeah,
had that issue of like you just walk into a room and you die. You should have known not to walk in the room. Like, you know, oh, the room was depressurized. I didn't do that.
Really?
I have no idea why he decided to do that.
Huh.
What? I did not do that. Maybe it's because I didn't... Oh.
Oh, you're trying to blow the gate open so you can get in.
Okay.
Oh, wait. No, it's a preview image.
Isn't that different than what we did before? Because I said begin new game.
Yeah.
And I thought for sure... Oh, this is what happens because we don't save... Okay.
He must have skipped past it somehow. Yeah, so now that guy's going to reanimate.
He's going to come
soon.
After me. I guess... I suppose I could try and take his gun away from him or something. Maybe try and kill him. Or I could just run away. Now, see, he's moving at a pretty good clip until he gets to the edge of the screen. It's got to load the screen up.
Right. But, wait. It's only a 2X CD-ROM. Come on. That's not going to be important later. What ho? Oh, geez, now you're getting swarmed?
Yeah, that's what I mean by this game. I think wants you to fight more than... I probably should have killed the other guy, taken his gun, and then shot these guys.
Yeah, could be. Ow. Oh, and now he's... I feel awful.
Really awful. Yay, I wonder why. Could be all that air conditioning you have.
Yeah.
So are these all going to follow me? They're really going to take the frame rate down if they do that. Can I get into the...
No, you tried that earlier and it kind of ignored you. Also, it doesn't look like it's an animated texture.
Yeah, that's true.
Because it's an actual texture.
Can I shoot? I can't figure out how to shoot this.
Yeah.
Oh, great. I don't want to fight. I'm not going to bring a fist. Oh, you headbutt, so that's nice, but great. Oh, I get it. Okay. Oh, wait. Did he just shoot his own buddy?
The guy behind him, yeah. That'd be hilarious. 1, 6, 1. There's only one of you. Wait. But there were three of them.
Did the other guy...
Oh, wait. He dropped it. Now how do you pick stuff up?
That's how. Take. Yes, thank you. Can I use it? Take. Does the flask
improve health?
It probably does. But I'm dead.
Oh, no. Alcohol poisoning.
Oh, no. You had to load that animation, or probably the sound effect of it. Yeah, literally.
11. Yeah, I guess it did help. Ah, that's better. And now you're being shot again.
No, I need to... And I'm dead. Yes, this is a brutally unforgiving game.
Wow, yeah, especially with the chunky frame rate where, like, you have to, like, wait forever for the thing to actually do the action.
The Sierra Online games are, like I said, you would literally walk in the room, it's like, oh, the room is decompressed, you didn't have your spacesuit on, boom, you're dead.
Yeah.
I hope you saved your game. And they put this annoying little dialogue, it's like, I hope you saved your game, you know, restart, reload, reload game, and they put, it's like this primitive early, you know, request or... Oh, there are no save games, though, because of...
Nope. There aren't any. Do you have to power cycle it?
No. But, so there's a section in Monkey Island, because after a while you start to notice, like, gee, I can't die in this game. How awesome. It didn't debounce.
Well, we're running the...
Yeah. So, anyway, but you're walking along a ledge, and the ledge just crumbles away, and you die. And it actually puts up the exact looking requester from the Sierra Online game. Like, I hope you saved your game. Ah. And it actually shows your guy, they see, you know, in the little box in the requester, plummeting to his death. Like, he's like going, ah! You know, I'm all screaming. And then, like, 2 seconds later, he just, like, flies up in the air and back onto the cliff where he was up. And he goes, oh, rubber tree. So it's like, okay, let's see here. This world, Siberia. Siberia is like another kind of an FMV game with like a shooter section in it.
Oh, yeah?
Out of this world. We all know what Out of This World is.
Yeah.
This will probably just be the intro. We should do Out of This World is one of the...
Originally for the Amiga, I believe.
Yes.
And then ported... In fact, there's... It's on GOG.com, G-O-G, goodoldgames.com.
Yes.
I bought that a while ago. It's...
It was actually a wonderful post-mortem that the guy who made this did on Gamasutra.
Oh.
on Game Developer Magazine, where he did a talk at one of the game developer conferences about basically how long it took him to make just the intro.
Wow.
And like the first few...
Yeah, the whole script, and this whole scripted bit here, yeah.
In the first few screens.
Uh-huh.
And, you know, to get that compression and all that part down, he got, like, basically, like, the first few screens, like, yes, this one took me, this part took me a year. Now I realized I had to make the remaining 90% of the game.
Yeah.
But, yeah, I mean, this is a, it's the same concept of static backgrounds with some animated...
elements.
With,
yeah.
Full shaded, well, not shaded, but, you know, color, flat shaded polygons, sort of.
Yeah, so, dynamically animating N-gons.
Yeah. To get basically how do you make a game like this that fits onto a floppy disk, you know, and you know a couple 800K floppy disks.
Yeah.
It's like, well, you choose this animation style where it's like anime sort of, you know.
Mm-hmm.
This is sort of like the logical product of something like Fantavision.
Yeah.
Not the launch, not the PS2 Aegis launch title, but the yes, let's animate vertices and flood fill the
Aegis Animator, I think is what it was called.
To get minutes of animation that you can fit onto a 800K floppy disk or a 720K floppy disk. Was it
880K for an Amiga? 880 kilobytes on a single floppy disk.
Of course, the original version of Fantavision, Apple II.
Oh yeah,
by was that Bill?
That
Budge?
Was Apple Vision.
Was that Bill Budge who did that?
I don't know.
I keep on saying it is, because I remember because I used that for a school project when I was in high school, was it? Or a math class and a physics class, because you could do like minute long presentations. That would fit onto 144 kilobyte floppy disk. But yes, this wonderful little intro scene.
And then something.
Well, those wacky science experiments gone wrong.
Gone wrong due to an errant lightning strike.
It's always lightning.
Why did you fire up the accelerator when it was storming outside?
It's always lightning. Yes, it's always lightning. Lightning and magnets. You know, it's like... Yes, this is why you need to be worried about CERN.
Just ba-koom. There you go.
Yes, 2 decades before they tried to find the big, was it the
Higgs boson?
Higgs boson, the God particle, as it were. This was happening. I'm sure some guys at CERN must have played this. So yeah, so now we're playing. Essentially, it's sort of like a real-time rendered version of Dragon's Lair.
Mm-hmm.
The 3DO version has a different soundtrack and. Much improved backgrounds compared to like the to the ones that came on floppy disks. Although apparently my understanding is the original creator of this does not like the 3DO version.
Oh really?
I don't know if he thinks that the backgrounds are too busy compared to what he had, if they didn't like match the art style. Oh, you can't jump over those guys, can you?
You can, but you have to wait. An incredibly incredibly hostile planet. It just hates you.
But yeah, I've heard this as like not directly from him, but like maybe because he didn't have anything to do with it, so it was like he didn't like the choices they made or something when they're redoing the backgrounds.
Uh-huh.
Backgrounds I think look gorgeous in this. I mean, they really. Now what's the? How do I?
Do you jump? Stomp on them or?
Yeah, I know. I'm trying to figure out what the button combination is. Okay. Yeah, because it's like the same one for stomp is the same one for run. That's what I was getting me. It's like, guys, you got 3 buttons here.
And some of these things are really hard to see.
Yeah. That may be part of the problem is he thought the backgrounds hid the the things. And now it's...
Hi there.
Run away! But I thought they did an excellent job on the port of this. I think my main... Well, I know I have to jump there, but...
Yeah.
I don't know if I can stop and jump, or do I have to like keep running and jumping? Or do I just run off the edge as opposed to jumping? So there's this jump.
Mm-hmm.
But
I think you have to jump on the what do you call it?
I know you have to hit the vine. I know what you have to do. It's just a matter of how do I do it. Mm-hmm. That's always a problem with games like this. Sort of like Prince of Persia has like the same issue. I mean, it's a great game, but my God. Is it unforgiving? I'm talking about the original, the 8-bit version, not the rewind time one, which is ultimately very forgiving. Where you can just parkour along everything. Let me just keep running. Nope, you gotta jump. Yeah. He stops right as you get the edge of that cliff.
I think I'll stop here. That worked.
I'm pretty sure the demo ends after you're captured. Or at least until you get the gun. The multi-use gun. Guys, use the button better. You got a whole extra button you can use, guys. Why would you map both the run and the kick to the same button? I know why, because you originally were on Amiga, which basically had one button.
Yep.
Because everybody just used an Atari joystick.
Yeah. Yep.
How would you support more than one button on the Amiga? What does C do? C does absolutely nothing. They could have used a C button.
And it's not a it's not according.
Can't do the old slide. Okay, we're done.
Yeah.
You get the idea. You played Alone in the Dark. We might play the full game on a Let's Play later. So I think there was like preview of coming attractions. I think I have every one of these games. Obviously, I don't have Waterworld. God, I wish I did. Sell that on eBay. Out of this world, I think I might have Siberia. I know I have Casper, but either I loaned it to somebody. In a little CD case with some other games and never saw it again, or my nieces have it. In which case, it means it's somewhere buried at the back of my sister's basement because my nieces have graduated and are from college and shit. But yes, fun look at the...
Yes, yeah, so the sampler disc phenomenon, so to speak. So, but anyway, thank you all very kindly for visiting. If you've got any comments or suggestions, let us know, and we'll see you all next time.
Hope you like Google Plus for those comments.